Nutty Cups it is. No! Come on. Hey guys, a little help?
Yeah, sure. All right.
Hey, nice. Got it. Thanks, man. Hey, do you guys want any of this?
No, we're good.
No, thanks, ma'am.
Have a nice day.
Hey, I'm meeting some people from the Crown at the weight room if you want to cruise by. All right. Welcome to the premiere of the Netflix Afterparty. I'm David Spade. These are the co-hosts, Fortune Feimster, London Hughes.
Hi!
Hi!
We're making history tonight. This is the first Netflix show to be hosted by three women. It's great having
you.
Fortune in London as regular panelists, although Fortune likes to be known as a flannelist.
That's cheeky.
Come on.
Yours is next. London's from the UK. She's here for many reasons, mostly because it wouldn't be an after party without a foreign girl looking for a rich husband. A lot of people
Let me
think
know
British.
When you find one.
A lot of people think British people are snobby. Once you get to know London, you'll see why.
Shut up!
I know, right away, right off the top.
That's not true.
That wasn't rehearsal. So what is this show? Seriously, I'm asking. I have no idea. Well, the Netflix After Party is a show where the biggest stars from Netflix come on to talk about your favorite shows. This is going to be a lot like other Netflix shows. If you can get past the first four episodes, it's actually pretty good. Yes! Tonight we've got comedian Bill Burr, a good buddy of mine. We've got the cast of Cobra Kai. They will be out in a minute. I was going to wear my karate gi, but it's at the dry cleaners. Long story short, when you go try to break a board, make sure it isn't filled with charcuterie. Meats and cheeses, a variety.
It's delicious.
Tonight, we'll be talking to them about season three. And I thought season three was them fighting COVID. COVID Kai writes itself. I almost forgot. Happy New Year. It's finally 2021. I don't know about you guys, but I'm so excited to be complaining about a different number. Of course, right now, a lot of people are making resolutions. I don't really make New Year's resolutions, mostly because I stopped keeping track of time after I turned 38. My only resolution is to get a McRib. It is back. People are very excited. Yes. So excited to make sure people take the vaccine. Pfizer is covering it in barbecue sauce.
Sign me up.
Fortune's front of the line. Some people may not need the vaccine. An American man recently beat COVID just before his 104th birthday. The man says he can't wait to get back to lying in bed all day. He says he hasn't been this happy since he beat the Spanish flu in 1918. All right, let's get this thing going. Our first guest star in the highly anticipated season three of Cobra Kai. Take a look.
I got a lead on Robbie, but I thought maybe you'd like to help. The whole reason these kids got into trouble was because of us.
No mercy.
We can't let them suffer because of our issues.
Code blue. His respiration is spiking.
The only way to end this is by working together. So, what do you say?
Nice. Please welcome the cast of Cobra Kai. What's up, guys?
Hey.
All right. Nice.
Cobra Kai. Cobra Kai.
Cobra Kai. right, real quick, we got William up there. We got Ralph. We got Mary down here. Tanner. And Sholo. Sholo.
Yes.
sorry. That's I was...
What's your last name?
Mari Duenya.
Close. It's... Now, you know, you might want to go with just Sholo, like Madonna. You
exactly.
Know?
I mean,
it's very
two
catchy.
Of the letters repeat, so it's easy.
Ralph will be with you in about 30 minutes. So, Mary... Ralph... congratulations, first of all, season three for all of you. But Ralph, you excited? What is this season going to be about?
Well, it dives deeper into the origins of both Miyagi-Do karate and Cobra Kai karate. Two areas. I get to go. LaRusso goes to Okinawa to uncover some secrets that he didn't know about the Miyagi family legacy and brings that back home to further his story. There's some great stuff. Everybody chime in. It's just loaded with dives deeper and more intense, and it's awesome.
I love it.
Yeah.
I love it. There's cool William Zabba Zabba Zabka. I love it. This dude is cool from the get-go with
He's
the Camaro.
So cool.
Yeah, I love it.
Oh.
Did you think this Johnny would end up the way he has ended up on the show?
At the end of season two, no, I didn't see that coming. Train wreck, and then everybody wipes out. Sholo's in trouble. I mean, Miguel's in trouble. We have a lot of healing to do. I love what they've done with the character on the show. I love what all the characters are doing. And season three is by far my favorite, and excited that it's out.
William, yeah. Are you in a dojo right now? I mean, what's going on behind you?
I took over Miyagi-Do. I had to find a remote location, so I took over Miyagi-Do and just checking it out.
That's nice.
He sells that Cobra Kai backdrop for
the
Zoom call.
Right.
Now, Sholo, the second season ended on quite a cliffhanger.
Quite literally, yeah.
When you read that your character might die, what did you think?
I guess, you know, at first there is a little bit of a surprise. You're like, oh, okay, so this is what they think of Miguel. But, you know, in all seriousness, our creators, Josh, Sean, and Hayden, are the biggest Cobra Kai fans, and they really have their best intentions going into the writer's room. So I wasn't too worried. You know, I think, like all the characters in our show, everyone has their highs and their lows, and this one might just be a little bit lower than I expected. But
that's cool. And Mary, oh my God, so your audition story is very unique. You're a bit like me. You hadn't seen the Karate Kid films beforehand. I mean, we weren't born, guys. How was it? Tell me about your audition process. What happened?
I slept through it. I got my initial audition, and I guess I didn't set any alarms. And so I woke up to my boyfriend calling me and saying, like, hey, how did your audition go? And I was like, oh, what audition? And he was like, you had that audition. I was like, right. And he was like, what was it for? I was like, oh, it's called Cobra Kai. And he was like, call and get yourself back in there. Whatever you have to do, like, offer them limbs. I don't care. Just, like, get your ass back in there. And so I did. And he was like, so who are you auditioning for? I was like, oh, her name is Samantha Lara Russo. He was like, are you kidding me? I was like, but luckily, Ralph was, like, the nicest guy ever. And we had a great time. And after that, I went home, binge-watched all of them. And in the middle of that, I got a call from Ralph. Welcoming me to the LaRusso family.
Wow, that's awesome. Yeah.
Mary, I like that guy's hair, your boyfriend, when he's, it's literally like almost illegally high. It sticks so high up, it looks like the Dow Jones with all the pokes, and it must be 9 inches. Have you seen his hair? It's gotta
be.
No. Anyway, by the way, these two up here, William and Ralph, you sort of did a switcheroo because it sort of switched from good guy to bad guy with you guys. That was interesting to see.
Well, it was, you know, we discussed it at the onset that the angle opening the show was how to get into the Karate Kid universe from a different perspective. And so through the eyes of Johnny Lawrence and William's character, whatever happened to this guy that we had little backstory of. So we knew there was going to be a redemption story going in. How gray the areas were and how LaRusso and Lawrence at certain times would become the antagonist to the other is part of the fun of it all. And that's the cool thing and the thing that's the most different from the Karate Kid films, which was so clearly black and white, good over evil, you know, Daniel good, Johnny bad. This show, Cobra Kai, all those lines are blurred. And I think it creates a deeper dive and a more multidimensional way to look at these characters is your allegiance changes on who you're rooting for, and that's kind of fun.
All he had to do was give Johnny a little redemptiveness, a little goodness. He was so bad for three decades. He was the biggest jerk. He was the villain. But it flips.
He is definitely cool to watch. It's riveting to see how it all unfolds. I loved it.
Now, I know it gets kind of serious on set at times. Tanner, how did you guys keep things light?
Well, I mean, that's the thing is, like, for me, I like to screw around a lot. I don't know. That's my thing. I dressed up to as a PA, and I planned this for a month and a half. There's probably only about three or four people that knew. Mm-hmm. And I specifically asked the hair and makeup team if they had a beard. And I really, really, truly wanted to show. I came up with the craziest costume. I had these short jean shorts.
Oh, there it is. Oh, wow. There's a picture.
Oh, look at that burnout.
Those are some short shorts.
Oh, wow. You cut those yourself. You can't even blame where you bought them. You cut them that short.
No, I did. A lot of people for like half the day had no clue who I was.
They're all like, why is this dude not getting us coffee? They're like, Tanner, do you know your lines for today? No, but I've got a great prank coming.
That's exactly what it is.
So you guys had a lot of surprises this year on season, including a blast in the past. Take a look at this clip. Oh, we know what's coming.
Allie, this is my wife, Amanda. Amanda, this is Allie Mills Schwerber.
We went out in high school.
Oh. I cannot wait to talk to you.
I was thinking the same thing. And it's actually just Mills now, no Schwerber.
Please welcome Elizabeth Shue. Hi, nice to see you.
Nice to see you.
Have a seat.
Hey.
You know those two clowns up there?
Yes. Hi, guys.
Hey, Lisa.
Hi.
Hi, Lisa. How are you?
Oh, it's good. Lisa for them, Elizabeth for us.
Lisa.
I know, it's my nickname.
Elizabeth.
Oh, man, this is like my dream right here.
She had a crush on you.
Oh, really?
I was like, oh, you guys are great. Hi.
I think everyone had a crush on Elizabeth Shue. I love it.
Yeah.
So many huge movies you were in. Now you're back in this. And did it take a bit of coaxing to get you to come back, or how'd it go?
Not really. No, I watched the first season, and you guys were all so awesome.
Yeah.
And I was just waiting for you guys to ask me, and they just took forever. And then, no, I'm kidding. But then I had to negotiate whether I was going to be able to do karate.
That's
because
true.
Because I wanted my own dojo.
Yeah. Oh, wow.
And I didn't get that, but Sam is a karate expert, so.
Black belt over here.
So anyway, no, that meant so much to me. I have to say, seeing you kick everyone's ass made me so happy.
Yeah, for sure.
Because, I never got to do karate. Allie with an I did not get to do karate, and I have a chip on my shoulder, as these guys know.
Had you guys worked, or had you hung out or talked much since The Karate Kid?
No, we really haven't seen each other. I saw Ralph, we can never remember when it was, but I think it was in 1986 at a baseball game.
Yeah.
And then I didn't see Ralph until working on the show, and it was so cool. I just walked around the corner. We were going to rehearse, and I walked around the corner, and there he was. And I said, oh, my God.
My God. There's a million things to say when you haven't seen someone that you're somewhat connected to in cinema and around the world, and then you run into them, and those are the three words that kind of came to our mouths.
Totally.
Which is a good thing.
No, it was so much fun. It felt like yesterday. I mean, it was just crazy how easy it was to act together and just how connected we all were and will be forever.
Yeah.
Aww. Ralph, was it hard to get them to get you to play Daniel again?
It was not when I heard the pitch. It took a long time. I heard many over the years and they just made no sense. This was just a smart angle in to that world. I mean, the film Creed was out recently, right before this, and that was sort of how do you enter the world of Rocky Balboa from a different perspective? So that had just worked. And the streaming services, the places where you could tell an extended story and dive into the characters and let them breathe a little bit more, as opposed to trying to just make the one blockbuster follow-up reboot. And these guys who write the show just are the biggest fans of this franchise. It's Star Wars to them, and I believe they were going to treat it like that and make the show the fans wanted to see. So I come up smart for some reason by saying yes.
And William, your character, Johnny, not very PC.
No.
If he were a real guy, do you think he'd be getting canceled?
Yeah, I don't know how he'd survive in real life today, but he's a lot of fun to play.
Yeah.
It was really funny acting with you because we realized that when we were on the, you know, on the Karate Kid, I only punched him in the face, basically. He broke my radio, I pushed you and punched you, then I punched you in the face. We never got to do a scene together, so it was so cool
to
actually be able to act with you.
Crazy. You were the only one, when we filmed Karate Kid, you were the only one in the whole show that actually punched me and connected every single time in the country club. It's like karate everywhere, and she's tough. She's really tough.
Yeah. Then she had Elizabeth. To go and run off with a guy in Karate Kid 2.
That was not true.
I was sad you didn't run off with a girl.
So, like, what was it like joining Karate Kid? When you got the call, was you just like, yeah, I'll do it, and then the world found out, and did your life change?
I mean, yes, there was a bit of that. The audition process was pretty long. I got to do chemistry reads with both Mary and with Billy, and then finally I was a junior in high school and I got out of school and I got the same call that Mary got from Ralph. And I remember I was walking in front of my house and my phone was on 1% and Ralph was like, you know, welcome to the fam. We like Parenthood or whatnot. And then it's even to this day, it's a little surreal. You know, I played a lot of tennis growing up and my mom would always say I look like Ralph Macchio. And I had seen the movie when I was super, super young, but I wasn't too familiar. And I was like, who is this Ralph Macchio guy? And why does my mom say I look like him? Like, he looks like me. Like, who is this? But no, not like that, but.
Ralph called me to tell me I didn't get it. I read for a small part.
You did? Really?
I actually did get a part. And I actually did get a part. I don't know if you guys remember me in any scenes.
You're a bad guy.
I got so many tweets being like, is that you on Cobra Kai? I'm like, no, that is not me.
You got a little social media going, Elizabeth, or no?
I have no social media.
Oh, you have none?
None.
Who have I been DMing for the last 3 years?
Elizabeth Sock?
Maybe, yeah. All right, I want to thank all you guys, but Tanner, Mary, Shola, you guys stick around. I have some chores for you to do. And Ralph, William, Elizabeth, thanks for being here. Season 3 is streaming now. Cast of Cobra Kai, everybody. Be excited. I am. All in one spot.
You've reached the office of Ted Sarandos, Netflix co-CEO. Please leave a message.
Hey, Tedlywinks, it's Spadoodle.
I hope you check your voicemail, dude. I just have a quick question about my parking spot. It says compact on it, and it's so little, I don't think any of my cars will fit. I think maybe one, but I don't want to drive the same one every day. And also, I saw where Obama parks, and it's so close. Could maybe we do a switcheroo before he gets here? Because I'd rather be, like, right up front. Oh, also, I saw that Prince Harry parked crooked, and it's kind of a dick move in America. So will you get word to him? And I have a bit idea for him. Does he do accents? Because if he does, I'll make him fucking hilarious. Also, last thing, just to avoid a kerfuffle, Frankie and Johnny, or whatever that show is, Gracie and Frankie, one's got a close spot and one's got a far one, and they're gonna be fucking pissed. I don't know which one, but I would save that shit show and get someone down there. Just put them together, either both far, or you get it. All right, I'm still doing that Kegger Sunday if you wanna buzz by, all right? Just drive by and beep, I don't give a shit. I'll just tell people you just left. All right. Audi 5000, buddy. Our next guest is a comedy legend. His last special, Paper Tiger, earned him his first Grammy nomination. Whoa, take a look.
I have a temper, so that's the thing. That's what kind of ruins things. Everything else I do is fine, but I have a fucking temper, and it just ruins shit. And then my wife always says the same thing. She's always just like, I just don't understand. Where did that come from? Where is that coming from? It's you just go from 0 to 100 in 2 seconds. It's like, first of all, I idle at 75 miles an hour.
Please welcome Billy Burr.
great. How are you?
So you know Cobra Kai. You like
this
show, right?
I love that show. Yeah. I've watched every single episode. I absolutely loved the first season when Johnny's got the Firebird and they're listening to REO Speedwagon. Like, none of that was funny to me. I was just like, yeah,
that's how you mean to.
That's how you do it. I don't know. I don't get the joke here. This is like, I loved it.
The good old days.
This kid said he met you before.
Where did I meet you?
Ooh. Well, I almost met you.
Oh, okay.
So here's the thing, and this is just full circle. It's super crazy. So it's like really cool to be here with you right now.
Well, wait, you're going to tell me where I met you?
Yeah. You know what? I'll tell you the story.
I thought I was going senile there. I was like, wait, did he get me the information?
So first season of Cobra Kai.
Okay.
I'm in the elevator, and this familiar voice gets on. It's a phone call, and it's a business phone call, and I'm like, oh God, that sounds so familiar. Who is it? And I look, and it's you. And I wanted to say hi so badly, but I had a battle with myself because I knew you were on a business call.
Because you knew it might be like this.
I would have said hello.
I just didn't want to interrupt you. I'm a very warm person.
I saw you. You won't remember this either. We were at the Comedy Store. No, I went to see you once. I was with Dana Carvey. We went to watch you, and we hung out backstage, and Dana thought you were great. Look at that. That's the old green room of the Comedy Store.
Oh, look at that.
Isn't that cool?
That's a great picture.
Fun.
I remember
and
that.
I've done probably in the last, since March, probably 2 or 3 sets. Have you been out? Have you done some sets?
Yeah, I didn't do anything until, I guess maybe the end of July. I was going to do, Chappelle had that summer camp thing that he was doing out in Ohio.
Yeah.
And so I was like, all right, I better get some sets in because I know Dave's going to be bringing the lumber. So I just did some parking lots.
Yeah,
you know, I
was there actually.
Yeah, the Magic Castle.
I saw one of your gigs. You were in the back of a pickup truck.
Stand in the back of a pickup truck.
Yeah.
And you sort of do stand. It's really taken me back to the beginning of my career. I'm just like, I used to do gigs like this. I remember this.
It's full circle. Buddy.
Yeah.
How did you do it, the Chappelle camp?
What I liked was there was no phones.
Yeah.
And it reminded me of like, stand up used to be fun.
Yeah.
People didn't take it seriously, and then I felt like, I can just say whatever I want again, like you're supposed to be able to. Like, it just affected all of my stand-up after that. It's just like, you know, it's been my experience. It's just New York and L.A. just live in this bubble, and they think that they're talking and representing how everybody's thinking, and they don't. And you go out on the road, and you can still joke about, people understand it's jokes. People don't start fainting. Because you said something.
Clutching pearls.
Yeah, it's like if 2,000 people go to a show and one person had a bad time, that's who they interview. And then like, that's what happened.
Yeah,
this
true.
Person was so upset. And it's like, they weren't. Not everybody's going to like you. So I don't know. I don't think things have changed as much as people try to say.
You got the white ladies upset after your SNL.
Oh, yeah. How was SNL?
Oh, yeah.
I didn't.
Yeah?
They just talked to the ones that were mad.
How did it feel trending worldwide for something, a white man going on SNL and just being like, white people? And then like the whole black community, myself included, was like, oh my God, this is amazing. This never happens. Was it the
side
effect?
I thought the Rick Moranis joke was going to be the one that would get me trouble.
Yeah, so did I.
I don't know. I just do the gig and then I just don't read anything. And then I just move ahead because it's not real. The outrage is, it's not real.
Well, there's no story in someone that likes the show. The story is in one person that didn't. And then that gets out, and you click on it right after I click on, what's the one vegetable Tom Brady refuses to eat? I click on any clickbait. It doesn't matter. I fall for all of them.
Yeah. And you are in The Mandalorian, so that's great.
Yeah. Baby Yoda.
Yeah. How are those Star Wars fans?
They're pretty intense.
Yeah.
They are intense. But they're intense, and it's a different, like, I usually have, like, sports fans coming up to me. They're a different kind of thing. But I found, you know, generally speaking, they're cool people. They're, like, totally into the show. And a lot of questions that they ask me, I don't know what they're talking about, to be honest with you.
We're so used to you doing comedy. Let's take a look at Bill doing some acting, because he's a character now. Let's see a clip. Show me a clip.
God damn it!
Having a day, huh?
A day? I'm having a life. My whole family hates me. And to top it off, Sue made me buy the Taj Mahal at Cribs. I swear to God, what would she be doing if she wasn't wasting money?
Wasting money? Like your set of 12 Colt Luger beer steins?
They're collector's items, Susan! They were the last ones with lead paint.
More yelling.
So good. I have to ask, who do you think has it harder, kids in the 70s or kids today?
I would say, depends on what direction you're going.
And
like
just
bullying, I would say it's easier now because you can then get on your phone and be like, you can't believe what someone just said to me. And then the bully ends up crying on the internet. But I would say as far as like, I don't know, as far as what environmentally.
Yeah.
Because that's what I do say to young people. Yeah, I'm old, but I know what four seasons look like.
Wow.
It's better just going from winter to summer with the whole state being on fire. If you're going to talk oceans and fresh air and food not being poisoned, I think I would go back.
Mary's crying. We better stop talking. She's like, wait, it's sounding a little bleak.
Yeah.
Even in your stand-up and watching F for Family, like, you have this brash kind of personality, I think, that people assume is you. And when I met you, what I loved about you, you're one of the nicest guys I've ever met in stand-up. And Bill's been incredibly supportive of me and my stand-up from day one. He saw, like, my gay jokes. And he was like, that's so funny. Here's a tag. And I never thought a guy like you would.
What does that say about you? You yes. judgmental so-and-so.
Yes. Wow. Yes. I was judging you. And I'm just blown away by how inclusive you are, how open-minded you are, and what a nice guy you are. And a
you
lot
should
of people
talk to my wife. She would say the exact opposite. No, if you're funny, you're funny. That's it. And I am a huge fan of stand-up, so when I see somebody new coming along that I know is going to be great, I get excited, and it makes me want to get better. And I saw you in the main room. I saw you in the OR, and you just had that thing. You had the swagger. You had the jokes. I just thought your vibe was so cool. So I wasn't watching your gay jokes. You were just funny.
I didn't really have a question. I just wanted to see you compliment me.
Well, Bill, thanks for coming by. I love seeing you. Hilarious.
Thanks for having me.
F is for Family, Paper Tiger, streaming now. Bill Burr, everybody.
Thank you.
By the way, some people think I'm new to Netflix, but I've been running the show the whole time. Take a look. All right, this is Love is Blind. Working title, Toyota Fuckathon. They will be going. We hope.
Wow.
Oh, wait, they can see? Oh, that wasn't my pitch at all.
All right, why don't you try to send them in by height?
I'm short, and there are women out there that won't date guys that are shorter.
You know what? I like this short guy, and I'm pulling for him. I don't know why.
You don't know why?
Sorry, did you say something?
Hey, why are these guys so underdressed?
It's like they're playing beer pong.
Send in somebody who knows what's up.
Here we go, Carlton. See, Carlton gets it, dude. This guy was not on The Fresh Prince. Is this the same guy?
Different guy.
Okay.
How you guys?
Hey, hey.
You're gonna love the host I picked. Watch this.
How you guys doing?
Ta-da! You know this guy from Backstreet Boys?
I'm obviously Nick Lachey.
He's from 98 Degrees.
No, he's from NSYNC.
It's Nick Lachey. I'm pretty sure it's 98 Degrees.
It is.
God dang it. Is it too late to fire him?
Yeah.
Well, I had it all planned out. He was going to say bye, bye, bye if there's three people. If there's one, he'd say bye. But if there's three, it'd be perfect. He'd go bye, bye, bye. And then I guess they'd go bye or whatever. All right, Nick.
Tell them what they're here for.
Here, you will choose someone to marry without ever seeing them.
I love it. I love it. They didn't see that coming. All right, Vanessa, give them some
preachy bullshit just to kill a few seconds.
We live in such a disconnected and distracted world. Your value is often judged solely by the photo on your dating app.
Eesh. Vanessa, why don't you
stay quiet just for a couple seconds.
Maybe till episode 8.
The only time you're going to interact is in one of the private pods.
There's my pod.
You know, I designed those. Did I tell you that? I was on ketamine, and I was scribbling down a napkin, and then I handed them in, and then they used them, and I was like, I was half kidding, but fuck it, let's go.
You're going to be separated by one thin wall.
Prince Harry, you know that guy? Him and Meg Markle, that girl he's dating, they met in pods.
That's incorrect.
Oh, it's funny, because your mama's incorrect.
That's not his girlfriend, it's his wife. They have a kid.
Are you a fact checker for Jeopardy? I mean, my God, I'm just talking out loud. I know that lady was married to the guy. I'm just talking just to be friendly, Jesus.
Game time. Get that wife.
Did you tell the guys to get Botox in their ball sack?
I did this 2 weeks ago. Mine were very wrinkly, and you could light a match on them. But now, it's like an Evian bottle.
I'm going straight for the candy over here right now.
I might go straight for the vodka, to be honest.
Hey, who put candy and vodka in the pods? I asked for Adderall and White Claw.
I have Adderall.
Can I have some?
Hey, no. Hang on. You have some and we can put them in there? All right. Okay, as long as Junkie Jill here can wait a few minutes without jigging out. Jesus. Get a PA in here.
You know what? I make the best Italian beef.
No, Jessica. I make the best Italian beef.
Yum.
Relax. After. There's only enough for two people. Rick?
I'm vegan.
Yeah, obviously you're a burnout vegan that sells CBD oil at the mall. All right, I'll get out of here. Oh, legs are asleep. All right, so I heard when you guys were shooting Cobra Kai, Mary had a thing about kissing scenes. Is this true?
I do. I have a little thing. I don't like to do it for the first time on camera. I don't like to do my first kiss on camera with somebody new. And apparently that was a little problematic for Sholo.
I wouldn't say problematic. I would just say, you know, it started at the chemistry reads, and she had mentioned this thing about not wanting to kiss someone on camera. So, you know, fast forward a few months later, we're down to the day. I'm reading the script. I know we have a kissing scene. And, you know, we go off to the side, and we're about to kiss, and she says, I think the best words you could have said to anyone ever. She goes, Sholo, I'm so nervous because you're like a brother to me. And I was like...
Right before you kiss?
I was like, oh, man, you know, we film in Georgia, so it's fine, but I was like, oh, man. I was...
To be fair, I am the kiss of death, apparently, for more than one of them. I actually transferred my cashew allergy to him through a kissing scene.
Yeah, I'm also allergic to a lot more things that I was not allergic to before, and I think it's from you.
My first kissing scene was in a movie called Lost and Found. Oh, nobody. And, and then the girl just said, I said, I feel weird about kissing you. I don't know. I never done it. She goes, just kiss me like I'm your girlfriend. She was European. She goes, I don't care. So I go, okay. So we got to it, and I touched her face and kissed her, and they go, cut. And she looks at the director and goes, can you tell him not to grab my face?
Oh.
And I go, me? And I was 1 foot away from her, and he goes, can you not grab her face? I'm like, I guess. Anyway, the moral of the story is it's tough to kiss in the movies, and it gets tougher in real life. So thanks for coming on. That's our show, everybody. Thanks to cast of Cobra Kai. Thanks to Bill Burr. See you next week.